Thank you for joining us. I'm Josh Landon. Two separate communities where blacks lived and worked in Detroit. We're talking about Black Bottom and Paradise Valley. Today, both communities are gone. Therefore, we go on a journey exploring the past and present and ask a very heavy question about the future. Detroit, home. In 2015, I came back to the city that raised me. This after living in different parts of the country for 8 years. A lot has changed. You love what you're seeing. Because what is happening downtown is needed. What's happening in Detroit is needed. You need some sort of progression. You have to start somewhere. Downtown is on the rise. It's like I'm reintroducing myself to what is home. But when walking the streets, talking to the people, I continue to hear about these two communities of Black Bottom and Paradise Valley. History in our own backyard. I tell you, I never learned about Black Bottom or Paradise Valley in school. Never. And you can only hope that the new generation growing up in the city of Detroit, learning about these communities. So we began this quest to learn more. Historically, this area was the source of the Savoyard River, which was buried as a sewer in 1827. French colonial settlers named it Black Bottom, and it became a residential community for people of color in the early 1900s. However, the people who lived here simply called it their community, where black people of all financial classes lived amongst each other. Take a look at this home, the photo taken on May 3rd in 1950 along Macomb Street, a wooden house standing on cinder blocks and children playing outdoors. This one on August 31st, 1949, behind 1536 Monroe Street, a group of kids standing behind the home as massive flowers reach for the sun.
Right here. Stay right there. DuBois and Condice, around the corner.
Bert Deering, the owner of Bert's located in Detroit's Eastern Market, takes us back to his childhood in Black Bottom. With segregation, blacks were limited to where they could live in the city. But despite those realities, this community stood proud.
We had horses, horse stables and stuff. You played ball out in the streets, basketball in the alley. So you played Wutapeg, you shot marbles. So it was always something to do.
When you take a walk inside Burt's, you'll see murals and maps of Black Bottom.
Being in Detroit all my life and just putting the history the way I saw it, or the people that I was around involved in. So like that's Young Barbecue, which was up on Shane and Waterloo, and different things that was in Black Bottom.
Not everyone in Detroit is familiar with Black Bottom, and there's often confusion about the exact location because the community no longer exists. Historian Robert Smith gives us a lay of the land.
Most historians think of Black Bottom being the area where Gratiot on the north end is a boundary, Jefferson and Larned on the south end is a boundary, and then Brush or St. Antoine on the west is a boundary, and then Mount Elliott or the Elmwood Cemetery on the east is a boundary. And so that's Black Bottom.
Jamon Jordan is a Detroit native. He began giving tours in today's city neighborhoods after learning about Black Bottom from other historians.
So this would have been houses, lean-tos, shacks, shotgun homes, and in some cases, two-story homes that were meant for one family, but you had three or four families living in it because of housing discrimination.
This compelling history of Detroit had been buried and kept away from the natives.
I was never taught about it in Detroit public schools. My grandmother and grandfather, they told me at home about it, but I never learned about this in school. It never came up by a teacher. I didn't learn about it in depth until I went to college.
But that's changing. Emily Cutle, a professor at the University of Detroit Mercy, put together this exhibit called Black Bottom Street View at the Detroit Public Library main branch on Woodward.
This is history that has been swept away, kind of buried, if you will.
I didn't realize the how powerful the history of Black Bottom is for Detroit when I started working on the project. And so, you know, growing up, I didn't learn anything about the history of Black Bottom. I didn't know what it was. I didn't know what had happened. And I think as soon as I realized, I mean, it was just like, it exposed this like hole in the heart of the city that I think was just, it's really, kind of devastating to realize, sorry.
It's an emotional topic.
Yeah, it is.
Ken Coleman has written several books on Black Bottom. During our one-on-one conversation at the exhibit, we also learned there's an effort to teach this history in the classrooms, starting with the city of Detroit.
Why is there so much interest with Black Bottom and Paradise Valley today versus 5 years ago, 10 years ago, let alone 20 years ago?
What's interesting about Black Bottom and its location in the city, it's a section of town that's seeing a lot of investment now. It's just outside of downtown Detroit. There's news about new commercial and residential development popping up in that neighborhood, and people wanting to know, oh, what was here 50 years ago?
So what happened to Black Bottom?
You want my personal opinion?
I want your personal opinion.
Eisenhower was the president, and I think it was indirectly by him being a general in the army or whatever that the freeway came through every black community in every big city where blacks were, and that's where the freeway came in.
On the surface, it appears the construction of the Chrysler Freeway leveled this community. But some share local artist Sidney James's opinion in saying this point in Detroit's history goes deeper than urban renewal.
This feeling, this community, they called it slum removal, but really, in essence, what it was Negro or black removal, if you will.
Historians believe city leaders such as Detroit Mayor Edward Jeffries put a plan in place years before demolition began on Black Bottom, with the effort continued through future Mayor Albert Cobo. The large community was condemned because the homes were old, beat up, didn't have indoor plumbing, and declared an eyesore in the city. The residents of Black Bottom did not own the properties and legally forced out in the early 1950s. Demolition started around 1955 and was completed by 1960. Construction of West Lafayette would go through the 1970s.
They wanted to test the theory as to whether they could be successful in taking the property. And so they condemned it initially.
So these photos were taken as a part of the eminent domain process. It was a legal process by which the city was determining the value of the properties, because through the eminent domain process, they had to pay back the homeowners. It's important to know that most of the people who lived in Black Bottom were renters. They weren't homeowners, so most of the people who lived here were not compensated. They were just evicted.
In your research, did the government look after these communities the way they looked after the rest of Detroit?
No, not
as far as upkeep, city services?
No, not at all. I mean, it was Black Bottom, to be sure, and to some extent Paradise Valley, were oftentimes ignored.
Gaining knowledge of what happens in our community can potentially help push us forward.
It's been amazing and humbling, and I think has really exposed to me like the richness of history in this city.
Arthur Jameson, Chief of Services and Infrastructure with the Mayor's Office, also weighs in on the past.
The neighborhoods were raised because they were deemed slums, and people said those neighborhoods aren't good enough to be saved, let's get rid of them, and all the implications that that had.
Well, I've been in the history of my life. If you don't know where you came from, how the hell are you gonna know where you're going?
What once stood as Black Bottom is now an interstate in Detroit. It's important to mention the pictures we have shown you here were taken by local law enforcement. Police officers telling people in Black Bottom they were planning to make improvements in that community. But we know that was only a tale. When we come back, you'll hear from a person who has a special connection with Paradise Valley. Welcome back. You are about to meet a 90-year-old man who remains sharp and mobile for his age. He shares his knowledge of Paradise Valley and the fight to keep the history of that community alive.
The end of Prohibition, that's what really started basically Paradise Valley as you know it.
During the 1920s, the black population in Detroit swelled from 41,000 to 120,000 as folks moved up from down south looking for work in the auto plants.
That's the address.
Where?
But as Jan Desjardins explains, many blacks became their own boss by achieving entrepreneurship in Paradise Valley.
The next thing you know, those people will have a bank.
Now at 90 years old, the family owned several businesses in Paradise Valley, such as the Pekin Restaurant and the 666 Nightclub. It was a district filled with other nightclubs, a bowling alley, theaters, and so much more.
Mostly every musician or entertainer really came there.
Paradise Valley began to expand in 1936, growing in popularity in the city of Detroit and across the nation.
The times were so dynamic then that people literally sang in the streets. They played their music on the corner. There was so much going on all the time. It was extremely dense and populated.
Marsha Philpott's father owned a record store called Joe's Record Shop, located at 3530 Hastings Street in a separate business district near Paradise Valley.
Paradise Valley actually was a relatively small strip of blocks that ran from Adams Street up north, just a few, two or three blocks. And so he was located near both of these places, enough so that his record store was kind of at a fulcrum of all of the dynamism that was arising from both Black Bottom and from Paradise Valley.
This is rare footage of businesses in Paradise Valley from the 1940s. The owners serving as everyday role models while living in some of the most difficult times. When you think about African Americans, for the most part, kids who grew up in the neighborhoods, they think about a Isaiah Thomas, a LeBron James, great people, great role models. But also know, you had a lot of African Americans who owned businesses just like this right here. And you hope learning that history, history in your own backyard. This is history that happened right here in the city of Detroit that many of us never knew about. It's like it was hidden, buried. And you hope that comes out and inspires more folks. This is a map highlighting the businesses in Paradise Valley. Take a look at this black line along Elizabeth between Brush and St. Antoine. It's no longer possible to stand at this exact intersection because it's something completely different. Something we enjoy on Sundays in the fall. The 50-yard line at Ford Field.
People are probably jamming what is now the 50-yard line.
Definitely. I think that, you know, there's so many places in Detroit where neighborhood histories are getting erased or that neighborhoods are getting rebranded or renamed. I think that there is such a loss there. You know, I mean, you can think about the kind of like the stories that are erased, right, of loss, the histories that are lost. You can also think about the physical structures, right, that are lost. And those things are tied together in so many ways.
One block away, there was a street called Orchestra Place. They've eliminated that. And they had was a hotel, the largest black-owned hotel in the United States of America at that time, plush, called the Gotham. The same thing happened to that, to John R., the flame and all of that. What happened with that? The medical center wiped all of that. They don't know about that.
The last stand in 2001, structures from Paradise Valley demolished as crews built Ford Field. The fight to restore them lost.
There were four buildings left. That was all that was left, the 606. Now, where the 606 was, that was not the original 606. 606 was on, that's why it was 606 Adams, that was the address. And what happened was that the 606, when Ford Field tried to, you know, when they come in, they said, we want, and we had three buildings, and we were arguing, said, well, we want to put a, create the whole thing, a Paradise Valley Entertainment District. Okay, so we were fighting that situation because they wanted all of the property, you see. We had architects that had laid out how we were going to do it, so forth, and we brought it to the council, and they said, yeah, well, we want to get this place designated as a historical, you know, historical. If we built the Paradise Valley Entertainment District, that means people would be stopping there and spending time there before they got to poor film.
It really makes you wonder if these two communities have survived, what it could have been.
I think about that, and I keep referencing New Orleans because I love that city too, and I think, you know, it's so intact, like its historic district is so intact, and it's like just such a beautiful place to visit and walk around and wander, and there's little businesses and there's people who really are participating in the life of the city in this way that is so urban and is so special. And I think, you know, that life in so many places in Detroit, Paradise Valley and Black Bottom especially, was wiped out.
That's the problem. No one is educated. The schools haven't done it. At one time they did it, you know. Like I said, every 10 years there's something that you have to do to kind of push things in the direction that what you're talking about.
At this point, we've learned about these two communities and some of the reasons why they are gone. In the final chapter of this journey, we ask a very deep question about the past, the present, and the future. It's a question that's not black or white, but rather very gray, and it's on the minds of many people who live in Detroit. Our final chapter is a candid conversation. On the surface, you can only love the development in downtown Detroit. New stores, restaurants, even a new arena bringing all four sports teams back to the D. In nearly one decade, this area of 1.4 square miles went from being called a ghost town to one of the newest attractions in the country.
You can go one way one week and go another way. The mayor, the planning or whatever, hey, they're kicking ass. I mean, this city is coming back.
With that said, what is the problem?
We have this legacy of displacement, this legacy of urban renewal, which African Americans at that time called Negro removal. And now we're living in a time with a different kind of displacement, mainly through what people call gentrification.
From his point of view, Jamon Jordan gives an alternative.
The other part is that this whole downtown development could have gone a whole different way had some of the long-term time Detroiters have been more included in this development plan, and people who had businesses prior to the fall of downtown Detroit had been supported in the same ways that some of the new businesses are being supported.
And not only are black people being displaced, like downtown, like the black businesses are being outpriced now, we're not even the faces of the marketing that they're used to market the new downtown Detroit.
If we're interested in bringing back Detroit, if they're gonna bring businesses back in Detroit, giving money to real estate developers don't create jobs. But giving money to someone who is has a factory or provides low-wage jobs to people who are not fairly well educated, that provides jobs.
As far as inclusion, when you look at the past, look at the present, do you think we're potentially seeing a repeat of history?
What I think we ought to do is understand that history and apply it to today when we are talking about redevelopment efforts and remaking neighborhoods. We want to learn the lesson. We need to learn the lesson of Black Bottom.
Chief of Staff for Detroit Mayor Mike Duggan, Alexis Wiley, weighs in.
What do you say to the folks who feel we are potentially seeing a repeat of history?
I think that, one, I will never argue with how someone feels, because that's intensely personal. I don't know what's going on in someone's life. But what I do know is that every single day, we are working to ensure we don't repeat history.
There is also the bottom line. Steve Ogden, Vice President of Government Affairs for Dan Gilbert's Bedrock Company, elaborates.
Projects don't work if the returns aren't there to take the risk, because the thing about a developer is developers generally put their own money in first, and they wait to the back end to make sure that they get a return, and they put their money out there and they take a risk. And so they are looking for some protections to mitigate that risk, and that's where these subsidies come in. And that's why cities have subsidies and abatements, is to entice development, to entice investment, to entice the creation of jobs.
It's great to see the art and the creativity whether it's from folks who grew up here or folks who are moving here. That part really doesn't matter where the ideas are coming from. I think it's more so the question of where does everyone fit in? Keep in mind, prices for downtown condos start roughly at $300,000. Parking at Little Caesars Arena for a Pistons or Red Wings game is going to cost you at least $45.
Is Detroit there yet with the market prices we're seeing today?
No. I think what's happened is now with the increased investment in these, in the, I'm gonna be very specific, in the downtown, and you could stretch it out to Midtown and create that 7.2 acres of 139 acres. And those 7.2 acres, there's been enough investment there to push the needle up, the market rates up. And they're not comfortable for a lot of people right now.
Here's another question I've come across when speaking to fellow Detroiters when it comes to the big developers.
Is the company investing in entrepreneurs?
Yeah, we do, yes. So workforce, I think, is what you're driving at, both entrepreneurship.
Talking about that person who grew up here, who has a vision, has the will, but needs a little help. Is the company looking at folks like that?
Yeah. With our retail master plan, we've been very deliberate about bringing in the large-scale national retailers that everyone wants to have within their city so people can go and shop there. And then also complementing them by placing someone immediately next door who's a small retailer, entrepreneurial spirit, who's opening up their first business.
Although Bedrock and the mayor's office both express including affordable housing in downtown Detroit, Ogden is also candid in laying out a certain reality in this new development.
Woodward Avenue is going to be expensive. Let's not kid ourselves, right? Just like Chicago's Miracle Mile, you know, Michigan Avenue is not cheap.
But I think it's important for us to have this kitchen table conversation, to create some dialogue, to talk about the approach, to talk about where we're going.
Again, it's participation. It's, you know, they're having a kitchen table conversation about what's going to happen.
Kitchen table conversation.
They're going to bring it, they're bringing it to the planning meeting. And that's what it's about.
Because, that's what this is.
Because if we're going to make it different together, we got to have those residents bring those kitchen table conversations to the meetings. And they are. And I think we're all better for it.
I mean, I think that's where you start in bridging the gap. You're having those kitchen table conversations, those uncomfortable conversations.
Yes.
This has happened before, and this is just a repeat of something that's the very question that you're asking right now, and the reasons why. This has been going on ever since that Paradise Valley era and so forth, so you've had different times.
Detroit is a city with a culture of speaking. We speak to one another. When we pass one another, when we pass on the street, generally, we tend to speak to each other. Hey, how you doing? What's happening? What you know good? What up, though? These are a part of the colloquialisms of human contact that we have here in the city.
I just think the flavor of Detroit is being erased to a certain extent. Flavor is the people that make up, you know, the music, the artists, just hot tamale man, hot dog carts, you know, people dancing on the street. You know, it's not as prevalent.
We did reach out to other city leaders and household names who own a big chunk of downtown Detroit, requesting that they participate in this dialogue. They were either unavailable or respectfully declined. But I want to thank everyone who shared their knowledge and candid thoughts on a very emotional topic. If we are going to rebuild the city of Detroit, it will take the natives and newcomers working together. And in order to reach that point, we must be comfortable having those uncomfortable conversations. For Fox 2 News, I'm Josh Landon.